Testing. Testing.
Wish I could describe it, but I can't contain it. Can't keep it to myself. There are no colors.
Well, greetings in the name of the Lord. My name is Joseph McDaniels. I'm the pastor here at Woodland Church. I think all of you know that, which is a problem. Y'all need to be inviting other people. Actually, if you look on your seats or on the seat next to you, you'll find that we have given you little postcards. We'll be putting these out every week. And what we want to do is encourage you to take some of these and to share them with your neighbor. Share them with your coworker. Share them with people that you run into at the store, and invite them to come to our Easter service. One of the things we find is that people come to church predominantly. If you ask people, why did you come to church the first time? It is almost always because a friend invited them to do so. Okay, and so we want to encourage you to take that step, take that leap of faith, take those postcards, pray over them, and hand them to someone that you think needs to come and be a part of the church community. So take those postcards, invite your unbelieving neighbor, and then pray over that person that God would move in their hearts, that they would come and be a part of what it is that we're doing here. And what are we doing here? We are called by the Lord to make a joyful noise to the Lord. All the earth, serve the Lord with gladness, says Psalm 100. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good, and his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is our God. Let's stand this morning and worship him.
as one, hallelujah. We overcome, oh, in Jesus, oh, in Jesus, hallelujah. Death is undone, hallelujah. Jesus has won, hallelujah. We overcome, oh, in Jesus, oh, in Jesus. Let there be dancing in the darkness, and let our song break through the night. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. Lift your voice and sing that Christ is King, for Jesus is alive. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all
pray with me. Father, you are worthy of all praise. You are great. God, you are Father, Son, and Spirit, one God in three persons. You created the universe by the word of your power. You sustain all that is by the word of your power. You are worthy of worship. And who are we that we should be called into your presence to sing praises, to amplify your worship, to give you that praise which you deserve? And yet you have called us and promised to meet us here. And so we pray that you would send your Spirit, that we might be renewed again and again in the likeness of Jesus Christ the righteous, our Lord and Savior. It's in His name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Hear the word of the Lord. As the deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night. While they say to me all the day long, where is your God? The things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I would go with the throng and lead them in procession to the house of the Lord. With glad shouts and songs of praise, a multitude keeping festival. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my God. My soul is cast down within me, therefore I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon, from Mount Mazar. Deep calls out to deep. At the roar of your waterfalls, all your breakers and your waves have gone before me. By day the Lord commands His steadfast love, and at night His song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with a deadly wound in my bones, my adversaries taunt me, while they say to me all the day long, where is your God? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my song.
You know, it's so often that our souls are cast down, that we can't see anything but the enemy in front of us. We can't see anything but the hardships of life and the difficulties that we face day in and day out. But God calls us to hope in Him anyways. And so I invite you now to go before the Lord and confess those places in your own heart where you are lacking hope. To confess those places in your own heart where you haven't trusted Him, where you haven't trusted His word. Go before Him now in silent confession.
My heart's desire, and I long to
so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. I want you more than gold or silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the to you.
Would you pray with me? Almighty God, you know that we have no power within us by which we can help ourselves. And so secure us, Lord, both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body and from evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. 1 Peter 1:3 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." If you are in Christ, your hope is not in yourself, it is not in what you do, it's not even in how well you repent or in the quality of your faith. Look away from yourself and toward Jesus Christ, who is blessed forever. Amen. Let's continue to sing his praises.
You came from heaven's throne, acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe. Your suffering for our freedom.
As I invite the ushers to come forward to take up the offering, I remind you that on Communion Sunday, we don't have children's church. And of course, the purpose of that is for our young ones, like the children of Israel long ago, are meant to see what's being done and to begin to ask those questions. What is this? Why do we do this? What is the bread of communion all about? What is the wine about? What do you mean when you say things like the body and blood of Christ? What is that all about? So we keep them in the communion service, but during the sermon time, it can get a little long and difficult for squirmy kids to sit still. So we do have a cart in the back with some Bible-related things, children's Bibles and the like, where they can leaf through those during the time of the sermon. But as the ushers come forward and take up that offering, it's always incumbent upon me to encourage you to give out of what God has already given to you, to see yourself not as an owner of your possessions, but rather a steward of God's possessions in God's kingdom, and to think and act accordingly. So give in that spirit. Well, it wasn't until many years after Richard had issued his panicked apology to Philip Yancey that Yancey had learned the story behind the collapse of Richard's faith. See, many years ago, Richard had sat in Yancey's office asking for forgiveness. Now, Yancey, a popular Christian author, had written the foreword to a book that Richard was having published, one that was going to come out in just a month. Richard no longer believed what he'd written in that book about God, he said. In fact, he didn't even believe in God at all anymore. And despite the long list of grievances that Richard offered Yancey as an explanation for why he'd given up the faith on that day, for years Yancey had felt unsettled about Richard's story. There must be more to it, he thought. And it wasn't until they met up years later for lunch that Yancey found out the origins of Richard's newly found unbelief. See, one day, while flipping through channels, Richard had come across a televangelist doing a massive, you know, one of those kind of faith healing type of services. And he'd only just begun to practice Christianity, and so he was in awe of the spectacle of it. And he was so entranced that when this evangelist came to his nearby town, he cut all his classes and he drove for an hour just to get in and see what was there. And he was stunned by what he saw. Right? So many testimonies of answers to prayer, healings from cancer to heart disease, other chronic issues. People would stand up and shout as if spontaneously, "I've been healed, I've been healed." One man in particular made an impression on Richard. He'd been carried in on a stretcher, but after he was prayed over, he stood up and he walked. He said, "I've been diagnosed with lung cancer, but I know today that God has healed me. This is the first time I've walked in months." Richard remembered that man. He remembered his name. And a week after this revival healing service, he decided that he would look this guy up in the Yellow Pages because he wanted to talk to him about his faith. You know, Richard had all kinds of questions about God and suffering and how to pray with faith and all those types of things. But when Richard dialed the number, it wasn't this man who answered the phone. It was his wife instead. And when Richard asked to speak to him, there was a long silence on the other end of the line. And then she simply said, "My husband is dead." "I can't tell you how that devastated me," Richard said to Yancey, recounting the incident. "The certainty that I had staked my life on died with that phone call." Richard said that every effort from that point on, his graduate studies in Christianity, writing an entire book on the biblical book of Job, seeking out Yancey to write the endorsement, it had all been an effort to prove wrong the feeling that came with the disappointment that he had received on that day with that phone call. The naive optimism that pushed him to make the phone call in the first place had curdled into cynicism. And despite what he did to try to beat it back, his cynicism eventually gave way to full-blown unbelief. "There's no one out there," he said to Yancey. "There's no God there to care." Today we're going to be asking how it is that we can pray with hope. And the reason we're asking that question is because, like Richard, many of us have been naively optimistic about prayer. Many of us, like Richard, when we've been disappointed with God's response, have quietly become cynical about prayer. Maybe you've even become so cynical that you two right here are on the verge of losing your faith. Now, the truth is, all of us are prayer cynics to some degree or another. All of us have wrestled with unanswered prayers that encouraged doubt. Each of us has wondered if something that we'd prayed about wouldn't have just happened anyways. And each of us at some point has wondered whether or not our prayers really make a difference after all. To one degree or other, we are all prayer cynics. Now, today is the third sermon in our series simply entitled Let's Pray Together, which is connected to our community group cycles. And if you missed signing up for this round, don't worry. We've got another round coming a few weeks after Easter, and you'll have an opportunity to sign up for that one. But in today's sermon, what I want for us to see is that God gives us good reasons to pray with hope. But in order to see those reasons, we may have to give up what it is that we want in order to receive what it is that God has on offer. And the good news is that while we may not get what we ask for in prayer, God does give us what we need. While we may not get what we want, God does give us what we need. And because of that, we can learn not to return to our naive optimism out of cynicism, but we can learn to pray with real hope. But before we dig in, why don't we pray together? Father, it's hard for us to live through the pain of unanswered prayers. And Lord, it so often leads us into a place of confusion. It changes our expectations of you, what we think you are and how we think you should operate. We get confused. We don't know where you are. And the pain often overwhelms us. We feel like we walk through the shadow of death, but there's no shepherd there to guide us. And so we pray, Lord, that you would renew our hope. We pray, Lord, that you would break the cynical spirit in us, the unbelief that pervades our lives, and teach us to listen well to your word and to have hope that what you say is true. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm not sure if you know just what cynicism is. It's something I had to learn about myself, a definition I had to fill out over time. And what I learned is that it's not necessarily just an attitude that assumes everything is going to go wrong. There's more to it than that. In fact, a substantial root of cynicism is a desperate and defeated spirit. It's a spirit that says, well, none of this really matters. Why bother? It's a spirit that's born of disappointments and broken expectations. It's the spirit of one who prays fervently with faith, but who feels let down by God in the end. In the same book where he recounts his conversations with Richard, Philip Yancey writes this. He says, I have found that petty disappointments tend to accumulate over time, undermining my faith with a lava flow of doubt. For some, a string of unanswered prayers, even for little things, can lead to questions about God's goodness and his love. Some can even come to feel betrayed by God. And many will begin to ask, does God even care about me? It's no great insight to see that suffering is one of the main drivers of our prayer lives. Right, much of what we pray for is the alleviation of suffering or protection from suffering or for our suffering not to go on too long. And we pray this way not just because it hurts and we want it to stop, but because we live in a culture that teaches us that all suffering is bad, that it's meaningless, and consequently that it should be avoided at all costs. Sociologist Peter Berger wrote that every culture has to provide an explanation of human events that bestows meaning upon the experiences of suffering and evil. In other words, stable societies have to provide their people with some kind of explanation for why we suffer and to teach us in some way or other what is the proper response to that suffering. Here's why suffering happens, and here's what you need to do about it. But the modern Western world has become, for the most part, a secularist and materialist world. Pastor Tim Keller writes, "In the secular view, the material world is all there is. And so the meaning of life is to have the freedom to choose the life that makes you most happy." However, he goes on, "In that view of things, suffering can have no meaningful part. It is a complete interruption of your life story." In other words, our culture doesn't do a very good job of providing us with that explanation for suffering. And it doesn't do, or rather, it does even less to equip us to deal with the suffering that we encounter. And while Christians may not think of themselves as secular, the truth is we are all more shaped by the culture around us than we would ever care to admit. Just think about the ways that we often make our plans. We consult the experts, but not God. We think about what outcomes we want to achieve, but not God's purposes for his kingdom. We plan our steps and then we slap prayer on the back end of it, hoping that God will make the stuff that we've planned work out for us. It's easy to go about our days as functional atheists, writes Pastor David Furman. We believe in Jesus, but we live like he does not exist. You know, though we would like to say that we are very much different from the culture around us, our faith is often more like window dressing than the foundation of our building. Right? We're often more like secularists dressed in religious garb. Okay? And really, I think what we've done is it's not really to exclude God from our lives so much as we have tried to paint God into a corner or put God in a box. It's as though we've tried to relegate God to the role in our lives that accords with our culture's primary values about self-fulfillment and individual happiness. Okay, what I mean is we think of God as someone who's there to help us achieve our happy and authentic life, right? To find us that meaningful job, the right spouse, the right group of friends. God's here to help me have the security that I feel like I need, and so on, right? We've almost come to believe that God is really here to help me with my problems and help me get my life back on track, right? And of course, that means that his part is to take away the suffering that's keeping me from that life. But what happens when God doesn't answer my prayers the way I want him to? What happens when he won't help me? What happens when God doesn't take away the pain? You know, when the disciples first began to follow Jesus, they had all kinds of expectations about who he was going to be. And you get the sense that they knew that he was the Messiah, the Christ, okay, but they weren't really ready to say it, almost as though it were too good to be true. Okay, because in the first century, the Messiah was supposed to be a kind of king, all right? The Christ was supposed to be a triumphant warrior who would vanquish all the foreigners, establish the kingdom of his father, David, Israel's greatest king, right? The coming Messiah meant liberation, right? It would mean freedom. And so the disciples were shaped by the culture they lived in just as much as we're shaped by the culture we live in, our culture's expectations for who God is and what things should be like. And so the disciples brought all these expectations to Jesus and saw Jesus in the flesh, but through the lens of their own cultural assumptions, right? It's like a filter. Whatever Jesus taught them got filtered through that first century Jewish cultural paradigm. And that's why when Jesus finally coaxes a confession out of Peter about his identity and reveals what's going to happen to him, right, that he's going to Jerusalem, that he's going to be rejected by the elders, and that he's going to die, right, the disciples simply can't believe it. Listen to how Mark recounts the episode. "And Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that I am?' And they told him, 'Well, John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, others one of the prophets.' And he asked them, 'But who do you say that I am?' Peter answered him, 'You are the Christ, the Messiah.' But remember what all of that meant to Peter. Remember what all of that meant to the other apostles. It means Jesus is going to enter his kingdom. He's going to sit on the throne. He's going to liberate Israel. He's going to establish God's rule. And for the disciples, that meant that they were going to be part of his administration. They wanted to sit at his right hand and at his left hand in power when he came into his kingdom. One thought of himself as the Secretary of State, the other the Secretary of the Economy, and so on and so forth. They were Jesus' inner circle. But their vision for how the Messiah was going to do things began right away to paint Jesus into a corner. It was to put Jesus into a box. So much so that when Jesus began to upset their thinking, Peter went so far as to rebuke the man he had just declared to be his king. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing the disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind on the things, not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Right, Jesus really was the Messiah. He really was the Christ, but it wasn't going to be like what Peter and the others wanted it to be. Jesus was the Messiah, but things weren't going to go according to their plans. Jesus was the Messiah, but all the expectations that they had laid on Jesus would be dashed long before they ever would be fulfilled. Peter and the other apostles, their hopes and expectations for who Jesus was, what he was going to do, it all shattered against the actual plans of God for his Messiah. We can only imagine what it felt like on Saturday after Jesus had been crucified. But look at what God was really doing. Right? The resurrection was on its way. Sunday was coming. It wasn't the way that they had wanted, but it was precisely what it was that they needed most. You know, the truth is, when our prayers aren't answered the way we want them to be, and we feel disappointed by God, even betrayed by God, oftentimes the problem is, well, it's not so much with God, but much more with our expectations of who we think God is, our expectations of what role we think God is supposed to play, our expectations of what we think God should be doing. Right, we feel betrayed by God because we think he's broken his promise to care for us. Because for us, being cared for means making sure we're happy and taking away our suffering. Being taken care of is helping me fulfill my potential and to realize the life that I want to live. That's the cultural lens that I wear, the glasses that I wear. To the apostles, being the Messiah meant conquering the Romans, not dying on one of their crosses. And to us, being the Messiah means taking away our pain, not bringing us into another crisis. So when we pray with this naive optimism that God is going to take away my pain and God doesn't answer our prayers, it's easy for us to lose hope, to become cynics, and to blame God for all our problems. Like Peter, we want to take him aside and rebuke him. Underneath our cries for help, it's as if we're saying, "God, if you really loved me, you'll do this for me. If you really love me, here's what you can do to show it." And then when God won't relieve our suffering the way we want him to, we start asking afresh, does God even care? But of course, the whole point is that the problem was never with God. This is what Rosemarie Miller had to learn the hard way. We talked some about her last week and her orphan mentality. If you remember, she was married to a pastor named Jack Miller who taught at a seminary in Philadelphia and who also pastored a church there and worked in missions. And he was a gifted evangelist, and so their home was always busy. Needy people in and out all the time. And most of those demands for hospitality fell on Rosemarie, his wife. And while her grit and determination took her along quite a ways over time, she began to become bitter at Jack, all the chaos that his ministry had brought into their home. She said, I began to hate performing outwardly while inwardly lacking a heart for the work I was doing. And then this hypocrisy only led to guilt and condemnation. She pressed on Jack to save her. She prayed that God would give her some relief. All she wanted was some control over her life, to get some kind of order and stability. And look at how this shaped her prayers. She says, I had allowed a root of bitterness to color my whole life, including my attitude toward God. I wanted him to release me from my predicament, but to do so without dealing with my self-centered love of control. I mean, right here, Rosemarie is a perfect picture of the way our culture teaches us to pray. We want God to change our circumstances, but we aren't so interested in him changing ourselves. We want God to take away the pain, but we aren't so interested in him forming our character. We want God to end the suffering and to make us happy, not to make us holy. But the reality is, God loves us way too much to stay in the tiny box we would put him in, and more glorious, too glorious besides. The reality is, he paid way too high a price for us to be left in our sin and unrighteousness. The truth is, while pain and suffering are a result of the curse, are a result of sin entering the world, they are also one of the tools that God will make use of in order to shape us into the likeness of his Son. Right, this is C.S. Lewis's famous quote. He says, God whispers in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pain. God refused to answer Rosemarie's prayers for relief, for help. The grace God wanted to give her was not the gift that she desired for herself. The grace that God wanted to give her was not what she had asked for, but it was precisely what she needed. Faith and presumption, she writes, look so much alike that only crises can expose presumption for what it is. Therefore, crises become God's means of forcing us to turn away from circumstances, feelings, and our own strength, and to turn toward God instead. Crises become God's means of forcing us to turn away from circumstances, feelings, and our own strength, and turn toward God instead. The truth is, sometimes we need pain to wake us up. Sometimes we need a crisis in order to uproot deeply sinful habits. Sometimes suffering is exactly what we need to give up on the project of our stubborn self-reliance and move into a life of faith that God desires for us. And the truth is, you cannot pray with hope unless you can learn also to pray with faith. Because really what you're doing when you have faith in prayer is you're not believing that God is going to give you exactly what you ask for necessarily. But instead, you're praying with a general sense that God is good, that he loves you, and that he delights to give you good gifts even if it isn't what you want in the moment. When you learn to have faith in God's goodness despite the circumstances, despite the suffering, despite the pain, that's when you can begin to hope in what God will do in response to your prayers. And in fact, we learn to see through the eyes of faith that while God may not give us what we want, he does give us what we need most. And in fact, he has already done that in Jesus Christ. The very last thing Peter wanted was for Jesus to die for him. Peter would have preferred to die for Jesus. He said so multiple times. If he had said a prayer at that moment, Peter would have said, Father in heaven, please preserve Jesus. It would have been to keep him from the hands of the elders and the scribes and the authorities who wanted him put to death. Peter would have prayed for protection from suffering. And because of his narrow view of who Jesus was supposed to be, because of the box he had tried to put Jesus in, he would have prayed away the greater salvation that God was working in his behalf through the death and resurrection of Jesus. Because Peter believed that what he needed most was for Jesus to stay with him, right there and there, for Jesus to remain with them so that they could follow him into his earthly kingdom, he was not able to receive the greater story that God was drawing him into, the greater kingdom of which he would be a part. And he was so compelled by his desire for Jesus not to suffer such a fate that he actually began to rebuke the man he had just called his king, the very Son of God. Peter had actually begun in that moment to oppose God. You are thinking of the things of man, not the things of God. Peter's vision of who the Messiah was, who he should be, what he should do, how his life should go, it was all so narrow that he had no more room in his imagination for God to write a different story, even though Jesus plainly told them so. And that's what I'm really saying makes us cynics when it comes to our prayer lives. We've somehow come to think of God as our cosmic assistant, our cosmic physician. He's there so that we can realize our own authentic selves, to protect us from diseases and car crashes and from scheduling mishaps and our own forgetfulness. And then when he doesn't fall in line with our expectations, we fall into despair and begin to take him aside and rebuke him. Thanks be to God that he does not give us all we want all the time. Because the truth is, God is writing a much better story for our lives than we would ever come up with. And it might include death, but it also includes a resurrection. That's what God was doing with the apostles. That's what he was doing with Jesus. God was writing a better story than their prayers could ever imagine. God was giving better answers to their prayers than they ever could have hoped for. He wasn't giving them what they wanted. He was giving them what they really needed. And when we begin to see, when we begin to remember afresh that God is good, we can see not just the death of Christ, but the resurrection as well. That's when we can begin to pray with hope again. Right? Because prayer in that context is no longer setting ourselves and God up for failure. It's not a cynical outlook. Instead, prayer is creating space for us to wonder how God is going to take our petitions and turn them into something greater. It's more about how he's going to lovingly take our requests and write them into his greater story. Prayer like this is filled with hope because it teaches us to begin to look for God, to look for him and his work in the world. The mystery of it, the wonder of it. It teaches us to patiently anticipate God's creative process in redemption and to know our place in it. And by the way, taking on this outlook, it doesn't mean that our suffering is going to go away. That's to go back to the old paradigm. Instead, it means being equipped with the tools to handle our suffering. It means understanding that in God's hands, our suffering is made meaningful precisely because it's connected to the suffering of his Son through which the world is being redeemed in resurrection glory. And what the disciples wanted, what they prayed for, what they thought they needed so desperately, it's not at all what they got. But what they got in its place was something far greater than they ever could have imagined. They wanted Jesus to stay alive. Instead, they got Jesus resurrected. Likewise, God will not give us merely what we ask for, but in his goodness and love, he will give us far more than we could ever imagine, even more than we could hope. And here's the thing, it's not going to look like what you want. That's not what it looks like. It looks like something else. You see, that's the thing that frees us from our cynicism. It's what frees us to begin to look for God's hand in the world, to look where Christ is at work in our lives, to be on the hunt for Jesus, right? To develop an eye for the movement of the Spirit in the world. We don't have to be prayer cynics anymore. We can learn to pray with hope once again. The question is, though, are you willing to let God be God? Are you willing to let God be God? Or will you go on trying to keep him in a box, paint him into a corner? Will you let him write your story? Or will you keep on trying to write your own? Because the story he wants to write, it may include death, but it also includes a resurrection. It may include suffering and pain, but it also ends in glory. Truth is, God may not answer our prayers by giving us what we want, but in the end, he will give us exactly what it is that we need. We've seen it in Jesus. We saw it with the apostles. Let's look for it in our own lives and begin to pray with hope once again. Amen? There is real cause for hope. Okay? And this meal is a picture of what that hope is. Because the thing is, Jesus didn't just die in our imaginations. He didn't just die in the stories. He really did die. And he isn't just resurrected as some kind of metaphor. Oh, it didn't really happen. No, no, no. The tomb was empty. Jesus stood. He said, look at my hands. He said, look at my side. Put your hand here in my side. Know that this is real. And so he meets us here in this place. His body, his blood. Word pictures, tangible words to nourish our spirits and our souls. It was on the night that he was betrayed that he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he prayed and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. His death and his resurrection. If this is your faith, this meal is for you. This meal is not for people who have perfect faith or have given up entirely their cynicism. This meal is not for people who have the perfect hope or who are righteous of their own accord. You don't have to be an especially moral person, as it were, to come to this table. You could be a wretched sinner as long as your hope is in Jesus. As long as your hope is in Jesus, this meal is for you. I want to invite the elders to come forward to give the offering. Serve communion. And if you are unable to get up and come forward, I'll explain how that works in a minute. Tom here is going to take communion to you. Just sit in your seat and raise your hand. But the way we do communion here at our church is everyone stands and comes to the center and comes forward and receives communion here and returns to their seats from the side aisle. I invite you to hold the elements until everyone has received them so that we may all partake of them together. But as we come forward, would you first join me in prayer? Father, thank you that you sent your Son. Thank you that you give us these, your bread, your wine, the body of your Son, the blood of your Son, to nourish our spirits. And Lord, we are so famished in this place that just breeds cynicism, that feels like it's so without hope. And Lord, that everything we hunt for and search for slips from our grasp, or if we attain it, it doesn't satisfy. Father, thank you that you give us real food. Thank you that you give us real drink, that you feed your people, even on your Son. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Stand, come to the center, come and receive, not because you are worthy, but because he has made you worthy.
Jesus, I come to thee. Out of my sickness, into thy health. Out of my wanting, and into thy wealth. Out of my sin, and into thyself. Jesus, I come to thee. Jesus, I come to thee. Out of earth's sorrows, into thy balm. Out of thy storms, and into thy calm. Out of distress, into jubilant song. Jesus, I come to thee. Jesus, I come to thee. Out of myself to dwell in thy love. Out of despair into raptures above. Upward forever on wings like a dove. Jesus, I come to thee.
His body, broken for you, take and eat. His blood, shed for you for the remission of sins, take and drink. Pray with me. Lord, we want it to be our strength. We want it to be our way. We want it to be our story, our set of expectations, but you turn all that over. Your kingdom is upside down to us. The outcast comes in. The high is brought low. The low raised to new heights. And Lord, so we submit ourselves before you. We bow our heads and bend our knees. And Lord, we look to you for your leading. And we pray that the lenses we wear that we would look at the world with would be the lenses of your scripture, led by your spirit, built up from within, made new by your grace. Lord, it's not our strength we stand on, but we declare that it is the strength of Christ that makes us whole. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing of that grace we have. The hope that's not in us, but in Christ through us.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only
If you count on the story you want to write for your own life, if you count on the hopes and expectations that you have because you live in this culture and in this world, I'm afraid there is no other path but cynicism, unbelief, a lack of faith. But if you let God write your story, if you believe that it is not you, but Christ in you, that your righteousness is not of your own accord, but that given to you, a gift by Christ, that is a story with hope. And hope that will eclipse even your expectations. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in his peace.